Now, today we will cover suprarenal gland along with some minor structures in relation with posterior abdominal wall. Here, suprarenal gland. First, we will see location, size, shape. Suprarenal gland, where it is located? It is located in relation with upper part of kidney, upper end of kidney, both kidneys, right kidney and left kidney. In relation with this upper part or upper end of kidney, these two suprarenal glands lies extraperitoneally and it is covered by two coverings, true and false. True covering. Now this is inner layer, which is formed by condensation of fibrous stroma of these suprarenal glands. And outer covering, it is false covering. As you can see here, below this suprarenal gland, there is presence of kidney. And kidney is covered by renal fascia. This renal fascia, after covering kidney, goes up, joins with each other near its upper end, and again it splits to cover suprarenal gland, and this renal fascia will form outer false capsule of this suprarenal gland. Now these true and false capsule of this suprarenal gland forms covering over the surface of this suprarenal gland. Now outer false capsule, it is derived from renal fascia, you know now this. It covers, and near upper part of the suprarenal gland, this fascia again joins with each other and finally shows attachment to inferior surface of diaphragm. Now this is about coverings of suprarenal gland. You can see here, these two suprarenal glands are different in shape. What is the shape of right and left suprarenal gland? Right suprarenal gland, it is pyramidal shape, or you can say triangular in shape, and left it is semilunar. Now these two, okay, we will see these glands separately. Before this, now in detail, before we will see this gland separately, I want to cover some things. Each suprarenal gland shows two parts, medulla and cortex. Cortex is outer part and medulla is inner part. Suprarenal gland as having these two parts, cortex and medulla. Medulla is inner part and cortex is outer part of the suprarenal glands. These are developmentally, functionally are different. Also structurally these are different. Microscopic structure of cortex and medulla is also different. We will see later on. How? Now, as you have covered this, it is covered by inner true capsule, outer false capsule, and shape is right suprarenal is pyramidal shape and left suprarenal is semilunar in shape. If you see size of this gland, height of this gland is near about 50 mm. Then breadth is near about 30 mm. It is thick, near about 10 mm, and weight is near about 5 grams. Now these are general features or in relation with height, weight, breadth and thickness of these suprarenal glands. Now we can see these suprarenal glands separately. Now upper is right suprarenal gland. In this figure we can see suprarenal gland in relation with anterior aspect and posterior aspect. These suprarenal gland, we will see first right suprarenal gland. Right suprarenal gland it shows, as it is pyramidal in shape, it shows apex, base, anterior surface, posterior surface, lateral border and medial border. Now apex, where it lies? You can see apex goes upward and base lies in relation with upper end of kidney, as it is a pyramidal in shape, right suprarenal gland. Now, two borders, medial and lateral. Medial border, you can see here, this one is medial border and this one is lateral border of this right suprarenal gland. This medial border lies in relation with inferior vena cava, and lateral border of this right suprarenal gland comes in relation with liver. Now it shows two surfaces, anterior and posterior. You can see here anterior surface of this right suprarenal gland, and in relation with this right suprarenal gland, near apex, you can see there is one vein. This is suprarenal vein coming from this right suprarenal gland. This is vein of this right suprarenal gland. Now, this one is anterior surface. And this anterior surface divided by one line into medial and lateral surface, or lateral part of this anterior surface. Now, this anterior surface is, as it is divided into medial and lateral part, medial part of this anterior surface comes in relation with inferior vena cava, and lateral part of this anterior surface, it comes in relation with liver. You can say bare area of liver. Now here, this is posterior surface. This posterior surface, again, it is divided into two parts by one curved line, upper part and lower part. Now this upper part of posterior surface, it comes in relation with diaphragm. It comes in relation with diaphragm, and deep to this diaphragm that lies costo-diaphragmatic recess of pleura. It is in relation with right suprarenal gland, posterior surface, its upper part. Now you can see below this curved line there is lower part of this posterior surface, and it comes in relation with kidney. Now this is about right suprarenal gland. Apex, base, medial border, lateral border, anterior surface and posterior surface. In the same way, left suprarenal gland. This left suprarenal gland, again, its shape is semilunar. And this semilunar shape, left suprarenal gland, it shows pointed upper end and rounded lower end. And again, this left suprarenal gland lies in relation with upper part of, upper aspect of this left kidney. Now, other parts of this left suprarenal gland, upper end, lower end, again it shows surfaces, anterior surface and posterior surface. It shows two borders, lateral border and medial border. Now in this figure, lower aspect, we can see left suprarenal gland. And this left suprarenal gland, it shows, now you know now, this one is upper part and you can say upper end, lower end. Upper end is slightly pointed and lower end, it is curved. Now these two borders, medial and lateral. Now this left suprarenal gland, again it shows two surfaces, anterior surface and posterior surface. Now this anterior surface of left suprarenal gland, here it lies in relation with, again it is divided into two parts, this anterior surface of left suprarenal gland, it comes in relation with peritoneum of this lesser sac. And therefore, this left suprarenal gland, it is divided into again two parts, upper and lower. This anterior surface, upper part of this anterior surface comes in relation with stomach. And lower part comes in relation with pancreas. In between these two, we can see there is splenic artery. And all these structures lies in relation with anterior surface of this left suprarenal gland comes in relation with lesser sac. This lesser sac lies posterior to stomach. Now this is about anterior surface of left suprarenal gland. Now this left suprarenal gland posterior surface. Now this posterior surface, it is again divided into two parts by one small elevated line, medial and lateral. Now these parts, posterior surface, it comes in relation with this. Now in relation with this, it comes in relation with first left kidney, and remaining part of this posterior surface of left supraadrenal gland comes in relation with diaphragm. This is about left supraadrenal gland. Now you can see upper end of left supraadrenal gland also comes in relation with spleen. It can extend up to this spleen. This is about surfaces, borders, and its ends or other cross features of this right and left suprarenal glands. Now, something about structure of these glands. In relation with structure, suprarenal gland shows cortex and medulla. As you know, cortex and medulla are structurally, developmentally are different. Cortex. What is microscopic features present in this cortex of suprarenal gland? In this, cortex shows three zones: zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis. These three zones present in cortex. And this cortex, it is more thick in fetus. If you compare size of this total suprarenal gland in fetus and adult, during fetal life, this suprarenal gland 1:3 ratio compared with kidney. If you compare with kidney, it is 1/3. It will form 1:3 ratio with kidney during fetal life. But in adult life, it will form 1:30 ratio with kidney. Means during adult life, size of this suprarenal gland decreases. Why such happens? Because in fetal life, thickness of this cortex of fetal suprarenal gland is more. Therefore, this fetal suprarenal gland size is big, or if compared with kidney, it forms 1/3 part of this kidney, or 1:3 ratio. Therefore, now we'll see structure of this cortex and medulla. Cortex, as you know now, it shows three zones. In simple language, GFR. To remember easily, G for glomerulosa, F for fasciculata, and R for reticularis. It is easy to remember. G, F and R. Zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, and zona reticularis. Now these three zones present in cortex, it secretes some hormones. Which hormones come from this zona glomerulosa of this cortex of suprarenal gland? It secretes mineralocorticoids, mainly aldosterone. Then second one is zona fasciculata. It secretes mainly glucocorticoids, and in this glucocorticoids, main secretion is cortisol. And in this last zone, zona reticularis, it will secrete glucocorticoids and some sex hormones, androgens and estrogens. Now these zona glomerulosa, fasciculata and reticularis, these secrete, it will produce and secrete these hormones immediately. There is no storage of these hormones in the cells of this cortex, or you can say cells of this suprarenal gland. Immediate secretion of these hormones from this gland. Now, what is role of these mineralocorticoids? Or you can say, what is role of this aldosterone? It will help in reabsorption of sodium from distal convoluted tubule, and with the help of hydrogen and potassium, or you can say exchange of hydrogen and potassium with sodium. Therefore, it will help in reabsorption of sodium from distal convoluted tubules, and it will secrete, if there is absorption of sodium, it will secrete potassium and hydrogen. Now, zona fasciculata, in this cortisol, what is function of this cortisol? This cortisol will decrease immune reaction. It will determine lymphocyte population, and it is anti-allergic in action. Also, it will decrease formation of fibrocytes. Now, it will also reduce antigen-antibody reaction. This is about role of this cortisol, which is secreted by zona fasciculata. Now, xenoreticulase, you know now hormones and glucocorticoids and some sex hormones, androgen and estrogens. Now, these hormones play role in development of secondary sexual characters. Role of these glucocorticoids, you know now, along with these sex hormones play a major role in development of secondary sexual characters. Now, medulla. Medulla, it will secrete epinephrine and norepinephrine. Now, these are secreted. These two hormones, out of these, epinephrine is more in quantity as compared to norepinephrine secreted from this medulla. Which cells present in this cortex and medulla, we will see. First, these are hormones secreted by this cortex and medulla. Now, in medulla, epinephrine and norepinephrine, this will play major role in sympathetic reactions. Now, what is microscopic structure? Now, microscopic structure of these cortex and medulla. First, cortex is divided into three zones. Zona glomerulosa. In zona glomerulosa, it will form near about 5% of this cortex. And cells are polyhedral. Now, these cells present or form arch columns in zona glomerulosa. These polyhedral cells will arrange just like an arch column in outermost layer of this cortex. Which layer? Zona glomerulosa. Then second layer, this one is zona glomerulosa. Now second is zona fasciculata. Now again, in this polyhedral cells present, but these polyhedral cells, it is forms a straight cords, vertical cords. Now these straight cords, in between this straight cord, there is presence of sinusoids and capillaries. This is about structure of this zona fasciculata. Now innermost layer is zona reticularis. In this zona reticularis, there is clumps or collection of some cells in groups. And in between these groups of cell, polyhedral cells, there is presence of capillaries and sinusoids. Now, out of these three layers, zona fasciculata is more thick. It will form near about 65% of this cortex of this suprarenal gland. Now, in this, out of these three layers of this cortex, you know now secretions. And now, you know this microscopic structure of these three layers of cortex, secretions, mainly aldosterone, cortisol, and in addition to these, in fetal suprarenal gland, there is secretion of dehydroepiandrosterone. What is the role of the dehydroepiandrosterone? Now, this will help in formation of androgen and estrogen during fetal life with the help of placenta. Therefore, during fetal life, thickness of this cortex is more because of this main secretion, dehydroepiandrosterone. Now, after these three layers, innermost is medulla. Medulla, again, in medulla, there is presence of cells. Which cells? Ganglion cells, chromaffin cells. Now, what is chromaffin cells? Chromaffin cells are cells which stain with potassium bichromate, and after staining it looks brown in color. Therefore, these chromaffin cells are brownish color after staining with potassium bichromate. Therefore, name is chromaffin cells, and this change in color or formation of brown colored cells is chromaffin reaction. Therefore, simply name of cells present in medulla is chromaffin cells. Along with these chromaffin cells, there is presence of, now these are chromaffin cells, there is presence of ganglion cells, again capillaries and sinusoids. Now what happens? Sinusoids and capillaries coming from cortex passes through this medulla, and finally there is exit of these veins from this medulla, part of this suprarenal gland. And which capillaries connect sinusoids of cortex and sinusoids of medulla will form suprarenal portal venous system. This is again system which is present in suprarenal gland. Now we know structure, secretion and microscopic features of this suprarenal gland. Now arterial supply and venous drainage. Arterial supply. This suprarenal gland receives blood supply mainly from three arteries: superior suprarenal artery, middle suprarenal artery and inferior suprarenal artery. Superior suprarenal artery, it is a branch coming from inferior phrenic artery. Middle suprarenal artery, it is a branch coming from abdominal aorta. And inferior suprarenal artery, it is a branch coming from renal artery. This is about arterial supply of suprarenal glands. Superior, middle and inferior suprarenal arteries. These three arteries are coming from different arteries: inferior phrenic artery, abdominal aorta and renal arteries. Now something about venous drainage. Now in venous drainage, right suprarenal vein and left suprarenal veins. You know now right suprarenal vein, it is a vein coming near this from this apex of this right suprarenal gland. And in left suprarenal gland, this is a present, it is present in lower aspect of this left suprarenal gland. Now this right suprarenal vein drains into inferior vena cava, while left suprarenal vein drains into left renal vein. Because there is developmental difference between this right and left suprarenal veins. This is about drainage, venous drainage of this right and left suprarenal gland. Now simple, after venous drainage, lymphatic drainage. These lymphatics from this right and left suprarenal gland drains into lateral aortic group of lymph nodes. These lymphatic vessels form plexus or network of lymphatic vessels just deep to this capsule, through capsule of the suprarenal gland, and finally drains into lateral aortic group of lymph nodes. Now nerve supply. Celiac plexus will give nerve supply to the suprarenal gland from T8 to L1 segment. How? From this sympathetic chain, there is nerve supply from the celiac plexus come to the suprarenal gland, and mainly it will supply medulla of the suprarenal gland, and this is responsible for which response? Sympathetic response. Means this is sympathetic nerve supply mainly for medulla, and this is about nerve supply of suprarenal gland. Now something about its applied importance or applied anatomy or clinical importance of this suprarenal gland. First, now this applied importance is mainly in relation with secretion of this cortex and medulla. Addison's disease. First, decrease Addison's disease. Now listen carefully. Decrease in secretion of mineralocorticoids. Mineralocorticoid secretion from cortex. Decrease in secretion of mineralocorticoids, aldosterone. Now what is effect of this decrease in secretion of mineralocorticoids? There is pigmentation of skin, increased pigmentation of skin, then muscular weakness, weight loss and hypotension. These are effects of decreased secretions of mineralocorticoids. Now, increase in secretion. First, mineralocorticoids. It will cause Kohn's syndrome. Increased mineralocorticoid secretion, it will cause Kohn's syndrome. What is effect of this increased secretion of mineralocorticoids? Again, now exact opposite. That is, what happens in this hypokalemia and hypertension? Sorry, there is slight mistake in this figure. There is hypertension. Hypokalemia and hypertension. Increased mineralocorticoid secretion. Now next, Cushing's syndrome. In this Cushing's syndrome, what happens now after mineralocorticoid, there is increased secretion of glucocorticoids. Now what happens if there is increased secretion of glucocorticoids? In Cushing's syndrome, what happens? There is increased obesity, which truncal obesity. Truncal obesity. Increase in truncal obesity. Along with this truncal obesity, there is hypertension and hirsutism in males. Means for there is increase in hair in relation with face in female. This is Cushing's syndrome. After this, adrenogenital syndrome. In this adrenogenital syndrome, there is increased secretion of sex hormones, androgens mainly. If there is increased secretion of androgens, what happens? In female, muscularization of female. In female, body will become muscular. And in male, effect of these androgens, there is precocious puberty in male. Hormone is same. Androgens increase in secretion of sex hormones, mainly androgens. And effect of this in female is muscularization of in female and precocious puberty in male. This is adrenogenital syndrome. Now, in relation with the suprarenal gland, there is pheochromocytoma. What happens? And this pheochromocytoma, it is a tumor of suprarenal gland. And in this tumor of suprarenal gland, there is, it will mainly affect medulla of suprarenal gland. And because of this tumor, there is increased secretion of this medulla of suprarenal gland and it will cause uncontrolled hypertension because there is increase in secretion coming from this medulla of suprarenal gland. Now you can see in this figure, in simplified form, Cushing's syndrome, increase in truncal obesity, weight gain, then fatigue, increase in risk of infections. Then in relation with skin, there is acne, thinning of skin, also formation of stria in relation with lower aspect of this pendulous abdomen. These are some defects in relation with this Cushing's syndrome. Also, you know now hypertension and all these things. This is now, yes, this is tumor of the suprarenal gland. Large and big tumor of this, and it will mainly affecting which part of suprarenal gland? Medulla of suprarenal gland. Now, after the suprarenal gland, I want to cover some small things in just near to this. Celiac plexus, intermesenteric plexus, and inferior mesenteric plexus. First, celiac plexus. What is celiac plexus? Now, in relation with this abdominal aorta, or you can say celiac trunk, and in relation with the in between this superior mesenteric artery, there is formation of plexus of nerves. And these plexus or network of nerves will form celiac plexus in between celiac trunk and superior mesenteric artery in relation with abdominal aorta. Now this celiac plexus, how it forms? Main contribution for the formation of celiac plexus is from greater and lesser splanchnic nerves. Now greater splanchnic nerve, root value T5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and greater splanchnic T10 and 11. Now these greater and lesser splanchnic nerve will help in formation of celiac plexus. Also, there is contribution from vagal trunks, right and left vagus nerve gives some branches to this celiac plexus formation. Now what happens? After formation of celiac plexus, in relation with the celiac trunk and in between the celiac trunk and superior mesenteric artery. It will form other small plexus in relation with structures or vessels near to this, mainly hepatic plexus, then gastric plexus, splenic plexus, phrenic plexus, splenic plexus, and it will give some branches to intermesenteric plexus. Now, what is the role of the small plexus? Hepatic plexus, it will supply these vessels and parts of this liver. Gastric plexus will supply structures in relation with this stomach. Splenic plexus will supply this spleen and its structures. Now, these are small plexus in relation with this. Also, it will help in formation of renal and suprarenal plexus. Therefore, celiac plexus is a large entity and it lies in relation with just near to the on both side of this abdominal aorta in relation with right and left crest of diaphragm. On right side, there is formation of right celiac ganglion and left celiac ganglion. On left side, it lies in relation with right celiac ganglion lies in relation with inferior vena cava, and left celiac ganglion lies in relation with this splenic artery. Now, these are in relation with this right and left crest of diaphragm. Now, after the celiac plexus, we will come to intermesenteric plexus. Intermesenteric plexus, again, it is plexus of nerve fibers, network of nerve fibers in relation with abdominal aorta. And you know now, main contribution comes from this celiac plexus. And in addition to this, lumbar splanchnic nerve gives some contribution to this intermesenteric plexus. And it lies in between superior and inferior mesenteric artery. After that, inferior mesenteric plexus. Now, inferior mesenteric plexus receives contribution from this intermesenteric plexus, and it is formed, again, it is a network of nerve fibers in relation with inferior mesenteric artery. It will give sympathetic nerve supply to left 1/3 part of transverse colon, descending colon, sigmoid colon, rectum and anal canal, mainly sympathetic nerve supply of these structures coming from inferior mesenteric plexus. Therefore, these are plexus in relation with this abdominal aorta: celiac plexus, intermesenteric plexus and inferior mesenteric plexus. Now, again, one additional part in addition to the suprarenal and celiac plexus, I will cover applied anatomy of kidney, because cross features and all the structure we will cover in demonstration. Now, what is applied aspect of kidney? Transplant of kidney. Transplant of kidney, there is one precaution during transplant of kidney. We have to take one precaution. The joint, each and every vessels in relation with kidney, renal artery, joint, end to end anastomosis of these arteries, because renal artery is end artery. Therefore, it is essential to join each and every artery from this donor kidney to vessels of this recipient. Vessels of this donor kidney and vessels of recipient kidney, end to end joining. This is essential because renal arteries are end arteries. Now, next is lithotripsy. Why there is need of lithotripsy and what is lithotripsy? Sometimes there is formation of stone in relation with major and minor calyces of kidney and pelvis of kidney. And if you want to remove that stones, sometimes there is formation of large staghorn calculus stone, calculus in relation with pelvis of kidney, and we want to remove that large stone without any operative procedure. For that purpose, there is lithotripsy. What is lithotripsy? It is extracorporeal shock wave therapy. And because of the shock waves, which will hit the Staghorn stone, will break the stone into small pieces. Now this process is lithotripsy. If large Staghorn calculus present is this pelvis of kidney, if we throw this extracorporeal shock waves on this stone or calculus, it will break into pieces and the small pieces can go out without any operative procedure, and it can flow easily out with the help of urine. And this simple procedure is lithotripsy, or you can say this extracorporeal short wave therapy known as lithotripsy. It is used when we want to avoid any operative procedure for the removal of these stones. Now, renal artery stenosis. Sometimes there is stenosis of renal arteries. If there is stenosis of renal artery, what will happen? Sudden increase in hypertension, or you can say hypertension is persistent. Now, treatment for this renal artery stenosis and to control hypertension, there is one procedure and two end, anastomosis. We can anastomose splenic artery with this renal artery to regulate normal blood flow to kidney. And whenever this normal blood flow to kidney is regulated, there will be control in hypertension. Now, renal failure. Next is renal failure. What is renal failure? If there is poor oxygenation of tubules is present. Why poor oxygenation of tubules? Because of this, when these tubules will receive less blood supply, it will cause poor oxygenation of these tubules of nephrons. And whenever there is poor oxygenation of these tubules, it will cause decrease its function. And because of this decreased function of these tubules, there is what will be effect of these? It will cause acidosis and hyperkalemia, because it will affect directly excretion of hydrogen and potassium ions. And because of this, there is presence of acidosis and hyperkalemia. This is renal failure. Now, two types of renal failure presents: acute and chronic. Acute means sudden onset, and chronic means slow onset. What is cause of this renal failure? You know now. Poor oxygenation, decreased blood supply to these tubules, peritubular plexus, peritubular capillary plexus. Whenever decreased blood flow to this peritubular capillary plexus, it will cause poor oxygenation of these tubules. Now, acute renal failure. Why there is sudden stoppage or sudden decreased blood supply? This is because of hypovolemic shock or hypovolemia. And hypotension means mainly because of decreased cardiac output. Blood coming from heart whenever suddenly decreases, it will cause decreased blood supply to kidney and decreased blood supply to these tubules of kidney. This is sudden, if there is sudden onset because of any reason. This is mainly, and this is sudden onset. Because of this, again, renal failure. And this is acute renal failure. What will happen in this? Again, acidosis, hyperkalemia, and in relation with urine, decreased output of urine or anuria, or complete stoppage of urine. This is because of this acute renal failure. Now, second, chronic renal failure. What happens in chronic renal failure? This is a slow process. If there is slow decrease in blood supply to these tubules or decreased blood flow to these peritubular capillary plexus, what will happen? Again, renal failure. But this is slow onset. And such things happens in mainly diabetes because of decrease in lumen or decrease in lumen or size of this small vessels supplying kidney or peritubular capillary plexus. In this, there is slow decrease in blood supply to these tubules. And again, in this, acidosis, hyperkalemia, increase in urea level, and this is again dangerous condition. Next, diabetes insipidus. What is diabetes insipidus? Increase in intake of water, thirst, and increase in output of urine. Polyuria, polydipsia. Increase in thirst and increase in output of urine. This is not, there is no relation of this diabetes insipidus with diabetes mellitus. This diabetes insipidus is because of absence of ADH hormone from pituitary. And because of this antidiuretic hormone ADH, there is increase in urine output, because distal cannulated tubule, there is no reabsorption of water. And because of this no reabsorption of water, because of absence of ADH hormone, antidiuretic hormone, there is increase in urine output. As increase in urine output, there is increase in thirst. Patient requires more water, thirsty. He will drink and urinate more. This is condition is diabetes insipidus. Now next, acute nephritic syndrome. All these are changes in relation with microscopic changes in kidney or structural changes in kidney. In acute nephritic syndrome, what happens? First, what is change and what is effect? In acute nephritic syndrome, glomerular capillary lumen get blocked. It is glomerulus, and lumen of these glomerulus capillaries get blocked. Why there is blockage? Because of increase in height of endothelial cells of these capillaries. And because of this, if there is increase in endothelial cells of these capillaries to glomerulus, what will happen? There is decrease in lumen, size of this capillary, lumen of this capillary. And it will, what will happen now? There is decrease in blood supply to this glomerulus. And what will be effect of this? There will be hypertension, hematuria, edema, and urea level will get increased. Now, next condition, nephrotic syndrome. What is nephrotic syndrome? Now, it is slightly different. Whenever there is any problem in relation with glomerular basement membrane, glomerular basement membrane, this is responsible for filtration in relation in this kidney. What if there is any defect, or you can say this glomerular basement membrane is simple language, leaky glomerular basement membrane. And because of this leaky glomerular basement membrane, what will happen? Proteinuria. Protein will goes out. It will be filtrated out. It will comes in urine. And if there is more proteinuria, it will exceed production of protein in liver. Therefore, there is hypoalbuminemia. Albumin level will decrease in blood because protein is going out through urine because of this leaky glomerular basement membrane. And naturally, there will decrease in protein level in the form of albumin in blood. This is hypoalbuminemia. And because of this decreased albumin level, decreased protein, there is edema in patient. Edema, swelling, in relation, mainly in relation with face and body. Now this is about nephrotic syndrome. This condition is in relation with diabetes, or it may be autoimmune. Sometimes there may be deposition of autoimmune products in relation with glomerular basement membrane. This will cause also nephrotic syndrome, and in diabetes, this nephrotic syndrome is present. But in children, sometimes this nephrotic syndrome appears or occurs. And this nephrotic syndrome in children, what happens? This is a automatic reparative procedure. And after some years, this will There is automatic repair of this glomerular basement membrane in children, and there is recovery of this such patient, mainly in relation with these children. What happens there? There is podocytes present in relation with glomerular basement membrane. There is problem or leaky, this podocytic process. These are not well fully developed or well developed, or you can say in relation with this glomerular basement membrane in children. In some children, it will cause again same thing, proteinuria, hypoalbuminemia, and it will cause edema. But if it is present in children, this nephrotic syndrome, it is get natural cure. After that, in relation with kidney, there may be some developmental anomalies. If you know development of kidney, developmental anomalies are common in relation with kidneys. For example, agenesis of kidney means total absence of kidney on one side. Then multiple kidneys, there may be more than two kidneys, three kidneys, because of early division of this ureteric bud on one side. Instead of two kidneys, there may be presence of three kidneys. This is multiple kidneys. Then next is polycystic kidney. In polycystic kidney, what will happen whenever there is one problem, excretory part and collecting part. If there is no communication in between these two parts, it will cause formation of small cyst in relation with kidney surface, and it will form one polycystic kidney. Then horseshoe kidney, whenever right and left kidney joined with each other in lower part, it will form horseshoe kidney. This is again developmental defect. Then disc kidney, when two kidney joins with each other in relation with this medial border, medial margin, and it will form round plate like kidney, and such kidney may be present. This is again one developmental anomaly. Floating kidney, sometimes what happens, kidney is suspended by one peritoneal fold from posterior abdominal wall, and this is very loose, and in at such time what happens, there may be tilting of kidney, and it may cause sudden blockage of vessels and pelvis of kidney, and sudden stoppage of production of urine, and sudden stoppage of blood supply of kidney. This is floating kidney. Such types of defects may be present in relation with kidney. These are developmental defects. Now one thing in relation with this kidney, one is renal angle. What is renal angle? Renal angle, it is an angle in between lower border of 12th rib and outer border of erector spinae muscle in relation with back. This is renal angle. If there is some problem in relation with kidney, if you press in relation with this renal angle, it will induce tenderness. Tenderness may be present in relation with this renal angle. Now, in addition to this, any operative procedure in relation with kidney, if you want to approach from back in relation with posterior abdominal wall, in relation with this approach, what happens? Sometimes you follow this again 12th rib, and whenever if you remove this 12th rib, and in relation with this 12th rib there lies pleural sac. During approach to kidney, if you go along with this 12th rib, and in relation with 12th rib there is presence of pleural sac. Sometimes in addition to this, what happens, 12th rib may be very small, and 11th rib mistakenly it may be removed. What happens at that time, there is direct opening of pleural sac, and it is a again very dangerous condition. This is all about suprarenal gland, celiac plexus, and applied anatomy of kidney. Thank you.